So now, in turning our attention to the nervous system, we come back to an earlier point made about structure and function. In the next two videos, we're going to carefully dissect, and no, I'm not going to show you any gruesome footage of me performing a prosection of a human cadaver or anything like that. We're going to be dissecting this diagram from Wikimedia Commons that lays out things in a conceptually instructive format and elegantly shows the relationship between the anatomical and physiological function-related aspects of the nervous system. The green bulleted points in each box identify the salient issues relating to the anatomical or structural end of things, while the red bulleted points cover the functional significance of the various divisions, of the peripheral nervous system in particular. We won't really try to talk a lot about the brain until we get to the end of this module, at which time you'll be getting a taste of what we know from the world-renowned expert, Vilayanur Ramachandran, in a couple of his TED Talks. For the moment, however, we're just going to try to get our minds around the physical layout of the nervous system. And the first level of understanding is that we identify two parts, the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system, that are separated not only in their locations in the body and their functions, but also in the way that they develop. The central nervous system forms in embryonic development out of a hollowed tube, the neural tube, that folds its way into the body from the ectoderm layer on the outside of the embryo. This happens along the entire back of the embryo from the head region all the way to the tail. Now the front end of this tube swells up and it forms the brain, and the rest develops into the spinal cord. But even through all of these developmental changes, the empty space inside the tube is retained, and this becomes the space containing cerebrospinal fluid in the ventricular system of the brain and spinal cord. If you've ever heard of somebody getting a spinal tap, this is a relatively invasive medical procedure in which a needle is inserted into the central canal of the spinal cord to collect a little bit of the cerebrospinal fluid for diagnostic testing. So anyways, the central nervous system forms embryonically with this one event of hollowed tube formation, while the peripheral nervous system forms a good bit later and from a different population of embryonic cells that migrate throughout the body and form the peripheral nerves that communicate between all parts of the body and the central nervous system. Relative to other body parts, the central nervous system is highly protected. All parts of the brain and spinal cord are covered by three layers of meninges, including a very tough, leathery outside layer called the dura mater. The brain is further protected by a skull, and the spinal cord runs inside of a somewhat flexible tunnel of bone created by the vertebrae. Each individual vertebra in your backbone is able to articulate with the vertebrae both in front and behind it, and there's also a large hole that will form part of the spinal canal through which the spinal cord as well as peripheral nerves run. The peripheral nervous system is basically made out of the same kinds of cells as the central nervous system, neurons and glial cells, and you'll be hearing enough about these guys, or at least the neurons, in other parts of this module. As I said before, cells of the peripheral nervous system develop slightly differently in embryos, and while they connect the spinal cord and brain with all parts of the body, we consider them as essentially separate from and outside of the central nervous system. And here's where we get to one of the important anatomical and functional divisions within the peripheral nervous system. If you think of the central nervous system as a sort of computer, and it's really, really hard not to make this analogy, you'll realize that in order for the brain to have any functionality at all, it must have both input as well as output. Your computer would be no good to you if there was no way for you to communicate to it what you want it to do, either through the keyboard or the mouse or voice command or whatever. There must be input. And if the input goes into the computer and the computer processes the information and generates all the information that you want, it would still be useless to you if there wasn't a screen or some kind of output device to relay that information to you, the user. So for the brain and spinal cord, there are peripheral nerves that carry information to the central nervous system from the outside world. These would be the input wiring, bringing information from all the sensory input cells that are out there in the body, and we call this the sensory or afferent division of the peripheral nervous system. And these input or afferent neurons are mostly isolated from the efferent neurons that leave the central nervous system and go out to the effectors, muscles and glands that respond to signals from the nervous system. You can think of these as the output wirings going from a computer's CPU to output devices, but another analogy I could use here is that these are like the marionette strings by which your brain is controlling all the muscles and glands and organs, and we call this the motor or efferent division of the peripheral nervous system. The motor division is further divided into two parts. First, there's the somatic motor nervous system, which innervates all of your skeletal muscles. These are the ones that you're able to consciously control, and this is why it's also called the voluntary part of the motor nervous division. The other part is the autonomic nervous system, which is also called the involuntary part of the motor nervous system because it goes to all parts of the body over which we don't have conscious control. Your cardiac muscles, the smooth muscles of your digestive tract and blood vessels, and the glands and organs, or your visceral parts. And sometimes this is called the visceral motor nervous division. The diagram also shows us that the autonomic nervous system is further divided into sympathetic and parasympathetic divisions, which can be thought of as both a functional and a structural dichotomy, since they are different motor neurons that reach out with sympathetic signals to our viscera, as opposed to the parasympathetic autonomic motor neurons. The sympathetic division is typically associated with a fight or flight kind of response. These neurons become highly active in situations where you're being pressed to act in response to immediate physical need, like if you're having to defend yourself or run away from a bear. If you've ever been scared or angered into an adrenaline rush, that's kind of an extreme manifestation of fight or flight. Your muscles will have become primed for lots of activity with an increase of blood flow and the preemptive release of glucose by hydrolyzing muscle glycogen. As this fight or flight response is occurring, your body will also temporarily be slowing down or shutting off the general housekeeping function, like digesting the food that you ate from your last meal. And these housekeeping functions are precisely the ones that are activated by the parasympathetic division. It's a real-life, bipolar, yin-yang way of dealing with things, a sort of physiochemical pendulum that swings between or balances the two opposing forces. Having sympathetic signals alone without the parasympathetic would kill you by making you ultra-agitated at the expense of some of your basic physiological needs, while being stuck in a purely parasympathetic state of perfect calm would allow you to digest your food, but you'd be offed by the first predator that comes after you. There's also one other kind of structural dichotomy when it comes to nervous tissue. Sometimes you hear people talk about gray matter versus white matter. First of all, gray matter isn't really gray. Unless, that is, you're looking at an animal that's been pickling for a while in a tub of formaldehyde. And if that's the case, most parts of the animal you're going to look at will be the same gray-drab color. If you were to look instead at the brain-splattering sequence in your favorite action movie, you'd probably be able to see that some parts of the fake brain are made to be a lighter, more yellowish pink. That's the white matter. While the other parts are darker, orangish pink, and that's the gray matter. From the standpoint of cellular histology, gray matter has a higher concentration of neuronal cell bodies, while the white matter is primarily made up of myelinated axons of the neurons. The basic scheme here is that cell bodies are where your information processing takes place. They're kind of like the CPU of your computer, while the axons are the wires that take nerve impulses from one place to another. The anatomy of neurons and the way they work is much of what we'll be addressing in the next couple of topics.